This disclaimer is a statement notifying the listening audience that the opinions expressed on any public affairs show do not reflect those of KX935, its management, or the board of directors.
I am a modern version of those that have existed in every culture. I am a guide. I take a small group of strangers on a journey of spiritual and personal growth with indigenous cultures in exotic places, only to introduce them to themselves. It can be terrifying to look at our fears, and sometimes even more so to look at our strengths. I take you out into the wild, into the unknown, for an inner journey. Hi, this is Inner Journey, and I'm your host, Greg Friedman. Sex, relationships, dream interpretation, or personal growth. I help by taking the wisdom of elders and making it work for you here and now. I'm a modern version of that which has existed in every culture, a life coach, a guide, a mentor. I've studied and done ceremony with Peruvian shaman, Aborigine elders, and elders from various Native American tribes, including the Yakanabe, the Lakota, and the Yaqui. The success of this show relies completely on you, the listener. All it takes is the courage to call in and ask those things that have been nagging at you. So you call in, I offer up my advice. Why should you do what I say? You shouldn't. All I ask is that you try it on, see if it fits. And if it does, groovy. And if it doesn't, throw it back up on the shelf. Not a big deal. So one of my big rants and raves is the necessity for rites of passage in our society today. We as humans go through many periods of transition in our lives. And rites of passage are those experiences and rituals designed to support and illuminate us through those transitions. With the rites of passage, we have guidance, direction, communication. You know what's expected of you. Well, the last couple of weeks, I've talked a lot about Dharma on this show. And the more you go through a rite of passage, the more you are guided, the less need you have for karma, the less need that you have to be bounced off of a wall or of a curb. You know, without it, we bump into those things blindly. You know, sometimes we're figuring things out and we just can't see. And so we're going to hurt ourselves. We can hurt others. And we don't have the guidance to figure out what is awake and aware, much less how to act from a place of being awake and present and in our grace. So it takes us dramatically longer to figure out how to proceed and where is the most appropriate direction for us. For instance, oddly enough, I am going to talk about this. There are two ways that a young girl can experience her first menstruation. She could be guided, mentored, and celebrated as she develops from a girl to a young woman. Or, without rites of passage, she could be self-deprecating, terrified, and her sexual psyche wounded or at least terrified. Look, it's obvious that the cultures that provide the tools to help us translate, transition, and celebrate provide a healthier and happier group of people that are more aware and more capable of being of service. Speaking of being of service, tonight, my guest is Susan Hough. She is a huge believer in ritual and that we are a community in the largest sense of the word and in the smallest sense of the word. And only with a small community, we're able to create a healthy, loving version of the world community. She's prominently involved with organizations such as Inspire to Action, Wisdom Spring, and I'm going to mispronounce this one, and I apologize, Sobenufo Somme, and locally with a women's group called Living Your Gifts. Welcome to Inner Journey, Susan.
So touched by what you just said. My heart just kind of blew open, and you couldn't have said it any better about how I really believe that, especially for young girls, the value of really being supported as they start their menstrual cycle and move into womanhood, and men too, when they hit that age of stepping into their power also. But it's so big. It's so powerful. We need to feel. We need to be acknowledged. We need to be seen, and we need to have elders.
And a container.
Absolutely.
Because without that container, we're just going to wander aimlessly without any kind of understanding of what's appropriate and how to make sense of this kind of information that's pouring at us, both energetically and tangibly. Please go ahead.
I mean, I can't even say how much I agree with you so much. I know that I was so lost in my youth because I didn't have that. I mean, I had community to some degree. I grew up in a small town, but I didn't have anybody really holding me in a way to help me step into who I am more fully and to recognize my gift.
That's pretty amazing. So I'm going to start by the end of this list of things that you contribute to, because it intrigues me in all honesty. Help me with the pronunciation.
Sobenufo Somme.
Tell me about that and your involvement.
Oh, that's just the sweetest story ever. And it was the most life-changing thing I've ever done in my life. Was I read this book. I had a mentor, and he said, you have to read this book by Maladoma Somme. And I read it, and it was a great book. It was called Of Water and Spirit. But then I realized that there was this other partner called Sobenufo Somme, and it was called The Spirit of Intimacy and Welcoming Spirit Home. And I read the book, and I just about went crazy. I love the book so much, because in this small village in Burkina Faso, West Africa, the women gather in this room together when the mom is pregnant, and the mother goes into a trance, and the baby speaks through the mother what the gift that baby's bringing into the world. I mean, it's just like amazing, and what that baby's needs are going to be. I mean, I read that, and I had been working with teenagers. I mean, I've worked with teenagers since I was 21, and I remember closing that book, calling one of my dearest friends, Jennifer, and saying, you have to read this book. You have to read this book. I mean, when I decide you got to read a book, you got to read a book. And I gave that book, I bet, to, 20 people. And then about 6 months into it, I was like, you know, I got to quit freaking talking about this book, and I got to find this woman. And I got on the internet, found a place she was teaching in South Carolina, and called. And I called them, and they gave me a phone number. So I started calling the phone number, and I started calling the phone number, and I started calling the phone number. And I was like, this woman is an author. She has two books. She's not answering her freaking phone. What is her problem? And every once in a while, this one woman would answer and say, hello, she's not here. So finally, one day, she answers, and she says, yes. And I was like, yes, what? Yes. Call my assistant tomorrow on this line, and I will do what you say.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so she said that her assistant said, there's a crazy woman calling you, and she's not giving up, and she's not going away, and that's why she said yes. And she just walked in through the door from Africa, and her ancestor said, say yes to this woman, she's never going away. And I'm not. I'm never going away.
Okay. So first of all, during the story, I just realized once again what a big twit I am. Because eons ago in a land far away, I actually was up in L.A. and saw Maladoma and
Sobenufo
speak. And she led chanting that was unbelievable.
Yeah.
It was transcendental. It really, really created a shift in the entire room and in every single being that was within that room.
Her name means keeper of the rituals.
All right.
His name means friends of the enemy. Her name means keeper of the rituals. You know, and they're not together anymore. And that's fine. But she's out there doing, they both are great, you know, healers in their own right. But I adore her.
So you got together with her.
I got together with her. I took her to Washington, D.C. and had her lead a ritual. And she's an amusing woman. She's
amusing.
She is so funny. And we were in the car, and it was my girlfriend Jennifer again. And we were in the car, and she's we're acting like we're really prim and proper. I mean, we were acting very prim and proper and trying to be impressed, to impress the teacher. And she starts talking about stinkers. And I was like looking at Jennifer and Jennifer looking at me. And she said, you know, after, and so we started talking about it too. And then she said, if you all had acted like, you know, didn't join the conversation, you're acting like my stuff didn't stink like yours. And we are all the same. And we just each have a different gift to give to the world. And if you kept acting like I was some guru, I was never going to do a ritual with you again.
Nice. I liked how you changed it forward and into with.
Yes.
Well done. Okay. So you do one ritual. And what's your connection with her now? And how do you participate? What's your, you? What
do you? They call me the white woman who does ritual over there. And I do a lot with Sabamfu. I set her up internationally and nationally. And I also am on her board, and I'm the youth project coordinator. I've put in 30 wells with her through Wisdom Spring, Inc., which is our nonprofit, to keep indigenous people alive.
So what's a ritual with her look like? Or what's a ritual with you look like? Mm. Either way, you tell me which direction you want to go.
They never look the same.
Okay.
I mean, a grief ritual, which is her main ritual, which everybody, you know, which I...
Well, wait. Before you go on about that, let me take a moment. Because we are local here in Laguna Beach.
Right.
And just yesterday, a local motorcycle officer that was really well-loved in the community, a man named John Cucci, was run over and killed. And I just wanted to take a moment to acknowledge him and all that he brought to our community, and to acknowledge his family meaning the immediate blood family, his family of brethren that are officers, and his family in the city. So, John, you will absolutely be missed. You are much appreciated, and you are absolutely acknowledged.
Absolutely. And if we were in the village, it would be a 3-day ritual,
mm-hmm,
where people would stop their lives, and they would come from all over, and they would gather, even if they didn't know them, the person, and it would be an opportunity to grieve. Because there is so many different kinds of grief. So as a community, we would stop our work, we would come together, and we would allow ourselves to feel, because to me, that's where we've gone wrong in our world here.
So what do you mean by that?
I feel like we don't honor the feeling we have. When you're sad, we say, suck it up. You know, move through it. Like when 9/11 came through, we didn't stop. We shopped. If we had stopped for 3 days and really felt the sadness and really connected with our neighbors and our loved ones and the community, we had such an ability to change the world right then. America could have done it so different, because we would have felt it and not gone to doing. We would have been being with each other.
And that's one of the gifts that ritual gives us, is the ability to be versus unintentional action.
Absolutely.
That was beautifully said. So I'm going to move us a little bit away from there for the moment, because I don't want people to think that rituals are just for things that are arduous or difficult. rituals are also designed to be celebratory and ecstatic. And tell us about a ritual that looks like that, if you would.
Well, you know, there's so many. There's rituals to help you change a story. You know, you would do a mineral ritual, and a mineral ritual could be something that would help you to shift a story to look at it differently. I mean, everything is about being able to find the beauty in everything, the deeper part. I mean, a marriage ritual. Do you know every 3 days, if you're married in the village, every 3 days you come together and you put your backs to your partner.
Mm-hmm.
And you can yell if you need to yell. Like, they don't listen. Like, the first time I did this ritual, I would have wanted to hear what the person was saying about me behind me. And Sabuff was like, you are not going to yell out loud, and neither is he. Because if you do, you're going to listen, and then you're going to be mad later. Which is probably right. So they scream at spirit about why they're mad.
Mm-hmm.
And then when they're done, and they've gotten it all out, they naturally turn around and offer water, because water is life. And water there is precious. So that would be like just an easy little sweet ritual.
Now that is a beautiful place to stop for the moment. Couple things. We are giving away tickets this evening. Last weekend we had three lovely Latina singers.
Mm.
And they were called Together Tres Voices. Sorry I mangled that. And separately, there are Kat Mendez, Fadia Morshi, and Ruby Castellanos. And we have two tickets to give away to the first person that calls in at 949-715-5936. That's 949-715-5936. And we'll be right back after this. Welcome back. You're listening to Inner Journey with Greg Friedman, and we're here tonight with Susan Hough. I just want to remind you guys, we are having a really, really cool event here in Laguna Beach. It's the first KX93.5 Festival of Music, and it's happening Saturday, November 2nd. We're actually having the festival on Day of the Dead. Interesting. So what's going to happen is it's going to be at the Festival of Arts ground. It's the first time in almost 10 years that they'd have had any kind of musical event there whatsoever. The lineup's going to be Colin Hay from Men at Work, Mal Costa, Carly Ritter, and Trapdoor Social. Tickets are $35 for general admission, and you could get them if you go online to the radio station, kx935.com. We have a caller. Cynthia has been graciously holding. Welcome to Inner Journey, Cynthia. How may we help you this evening?
Well, first of all, thank you for taking my call and for and earlier about talking about the rituals and most particularly about girls and when they reach puberty. I thought that was really good. I'm actually calling for something completely different about a dream I had, and I was just wondering if you do a dream interpretation.
Absolutely. Go ahead.
Okay, so I had a dream that I was in an old wooden home and that I was surrounded by a lot of aristocrats, and they're all dressed like they belong in the Victorian era. But outside, everything is kind of modernized, and I can see it through the windows. But in a corner, in a kind of dark corner, there's a ghost. But I just kind of go about my way, and I spot a young lady that says that the house has been in the family for over 200 years. But I just continue to roam around, and that's kind of how the dream ends. But even before the dream, it was a transition. So before that, I actually had a dream before that. And I was, in a university made out of marble, and I had
Wait a second. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to stop you, and we're going to do the second one first, oddly enough, since that's the way you laid it out to us.
Okay.
So if it's okay with you, Susan, I'm going to go ahead.
Okay.
So that house represents you. That's how you feel about you. So on some level, you see yourself as a more traditional, older, as in an old soul, structured, and yet with Victorian, very elegant and proper. And then when you look outside, you see how modern it is, and there's this glass that's separating you that says to you, somehow these two things don't quite go together. At least that's the mindset. And the truth is, the juxtaposition is gorgeous. The beauty of what you bring by being that Victorian style and that elegance and that beautiful old wooden home is absolutely astounding and stands out even more gorgeously in contrast to the modern world that you see. It doesn't separate you. What it does is it's your own personal expression of you. And it's not about fitting in. It's about being. And then you talk about that ghost in the corner. That ghost in the corner, what do you think that might mean?
I had no idea. He was, he looked older. He had a walking cane.
Okay.
I'm not sure.
Take a wild guess.
Somebody in my family? I don't know.
The answer is yes. The answer is he represents ancestral energy. He is your lineage. He is always going to be a part of who you are. He's not going to be a dominant feature, but he's always going to be a component of who you are and how you represent yourself and who shows up in this world. Does that make sense?
Someone he's a figurative person maybe not.
Okay, so it's not as important if he is a single person or not. It is dramatically more important in what he represents. and he represents your ancestral lineage. Excuse me for.
Okay.
Does that make sense now?
Yes, that makes sense.
Okay. Did you have anything you wanted to add to that, Susan?
I did have something I wanted to add to it. I was thinking, you know, when you said the wood, it's there's something about you that you need to connect more. There's an innate ability I'm hearing that you have with connection to nature and the nature world and the magical world. And when you said Victorian, what I got was there's a gift from your ancestral lineage that you are bringing forth in this time. That they're calling upon you to connect with that magical component of you, that deeper part of your being that you are to bring into the world. And for me, the home is your heart. And so you are bringing this magic through the connection you have in with your own heart and with other people's heart and nature. And that your ancestors, the ghost is your ancestors saying, okay, bring it on. It's time.
Okay.
Did that make sense to you?
Yeah. It's time.
And what year were you born in? I'd like to know.
She asks everybody this, by the way.
88.
And you are a nature person. So I thought you were going to be a nature person. So in the African tradition, a 3 and an 8 means you are in the nature clan, which means you are about magic, miracles, change, transformation, helping people to really see the magic in the little things in life, not necessarily the big things too, but that you can create that. So you are doing exactly what you're supposed to be doing, my dear one.
Oh, thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, Cynthia, do you still want to talk about that first dream?
The first dream was, I guess, I'm at a Marble University, and I have to find this building, and I'm shown a map, and I can see that it's really close, but everyone else around me keeps telling me that it's really far away, but I can almost see it, almost feel the building. And then I transition into the other.
Perfect. Susie and I are going to have the same answer about this, so I'm going to have her go first this time.
Oh, my gosh. I mean, you are in a marble room, which is about the story. So you're going from the marble room into nature with your heart coming open. And in Africa, minerals are about changing the story. You are bringing the old story into the new. I am just so, I got goosebumps from head to toes. It's just so exciting. What a wonderful dream you just gave us. And the beauty of dreams, it can be everybody's dream. You just shared a dream that everybody can manifest. So thank you.
All right, Cynthia. So that was the first part of your dream. The second part of your dream was about the distance. So I'm going to do the same thing that I did last time. I'm going to ask you what you think that means. I'm going to tell you why I do that. Often we know a great deal more than we believe we know. And just even being asked the question, it's often there as long as we don't think too much about it. So what do you think that part of the dream means?
Well, since everyone is telling me that it's really far away, but I can see it so close, maybe it's far away to them, but it's really close to me. I don't know.
No, that was perfect. That was exactly right. You have the map. You know where you're supposed to go. You have it handled. Whatever else is far away to them is far away to them. And you have to allow for them to have their own far away feelings. And not let that fear you from your own path.
Okay.
And Susan just did a little ta-da. You could say ta-da.
That's fabulous. How exciting, honey.
Thank you very much for calling in. Feel free to call in anytime. And also, don't forget to like us on Facebook. It's Inner Journey with Greg Friedman. Thanks, Cynthia.
Okay. Thank you.
Before we went away to break, you hinted a couple of times at this whole water thing. And there's an organization that you work with called?
Wisdom Spring, Inc.
And Wisdom Spring, Inc. is what?
It's about keeping the indigenous cultures alive through water, education, and medical. But I deal mostly with the water and the education, and I do youth projects. And what I try to do is get kids to find their gift in the project. And so just like in the village, you have a special gift to bring into the world. So I have them bring that gift forward in the project. And so we put in water in Africa, and it's just the best.
And why is that so important?
Well, without water, there is no life. And the indigenous spirit, we need that. Like, people are like, oh, you give them water. And I'm like, no, they give me life. They give me this wisdom that needs to be awakened in all of us that we've forgotten about. And I have such gratitude to bring them water because they bring me so much more.
And so what did the village look like before there was water put in?
Well, I mean, it's the Sahara Desert.
Well, I'm doing my best to really have you
right?
illustrate
I mean,
what the conditions
the women
are
walk
before and
6
after.
To 12 hours for water. Hours every day. Sabunfu remembers walking at the age of 5 and spilling a mile before she got home. Spilling it and just crying.
That must have been
and
so
crying,
traumatic.
You know. And we just take it so for granted. And then when she came over here, she tells this great story, like she'd never been anywhere but Africa, and then arrives in Michigan, right? And there's white stuff on the ground. And she's like, oh, what's this? It's so beautiful. You know, and she's used to this freaking 120 degree weather sometimes, you know. So she said she got, you know, they made her put a coat on. She didn't even, she'd never seen a coat even. And she gets home and she sees a faucet. She said, I would go in and turn it on, and I would write to my elders that there's this magic and it comes through this faucet. And you know, the reality is, it is magic.
Mm-hmm.
We take it for granted, and it's magic.
Right. Absolutely. So there's this village that has no water. They have to walk every day miles and miles and haul back ridiculous. If anybody's ever hauled water, even in a small bucket, they know how ungodly heavy it is. And they have to do this. And what you do is you go into this village and what?
We bring them, well, for one thing, they get freaked out because they've never seen any drilling equipment. So like Sabunfu will go ahead and say, oh, because we've strategically put it so we can cut down as much possible traveling for the women and the children. And so she goes in ahead, and they think that some monster's coming in. When they come in with the drilling equipment, she has to have somebody from her family to go and say, no, remember, I'm bringing you water, you know. And so then we go and we drill the water. And they do it with the divining rod to find the place. It's so cool. It was so awesome, you know. And it's just, they're just amazing. They're just amazingly great. You know, such gratitude.
And how does that change the landscape of their lives?
I mean, they can go to school. They can drink. They can start to have, you know, food.
Go back to the first one. It's really important for people here because we don't always get it because there are so many things that are just taken for granted because we're born with it, literally. So because they don't have to walk 6 to 12 hours a day, they're now free with all that time to do things like educate themselves.
And they are so excited about being educated. I mean, here, kids don't realize, you know, what life would be like without an education. And so when I went to the school in the village, like I took crayons, you know, they'd never seen it. You know, here, if you took one crayon to each kid in a school, they'd be fighting over what color they were going to get.
Mm-hmm.
They were so happy, and they were sharing it, and they were just, I mean, I can't even tell you the joy you feel and the ability to put a kid into school. We always put orphan girls first in school because girls are not put in school as often over there.
Mm-hmm.
And then we put in orphan boys, and then we put in other kids. And we even have agreements signed because we don't want parents to then pull them out to have them walk, as you know. We want it to know that these kids are going to be going to school and they're going to be doing what we say they need to do. So it's important. It's valuable. It's amazing. It changes everything. It gives them abilities to, you know, everything, not have the disease they have, you know, the kids with the big bellies, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, you think that's just pictures that you see, but I mean, it's just a totally different life. but they are happier than we are.
What do you mean by that?
I have never in my life, the first time I went to the village, there was 10 of us in a van, and we had chickens underneath our feet, and it's 115 degrees, and we get to a certain point. I mean, there are no roads. I mean, forget roads. There aren't any. And they say, we see these two boys on those old-fashioned, you know, those big wheel bicycles that you see in pictures on these bikes. And they kind of block where the van, and they say, you can't go any further, right? So we all get out of the van, and we're walking up this hill. And we come to this top of this hill, and there's probably 600 people, like, singing, dancing, just so happy. And I look at Sabonfu and I say, are they doing this because we're bringing them water? And she says, no, they do this because when people come home and haven't been at home, that's how much they value each person, that people will travel hours to come and see their loved one, because life is so short and community is so important.
What you guys can hear, but I get to see, is how incredibly choked up and on the verge of tears that Susan gets with joy at expressing this. It's so much. You could see her back in Africa when she's telling stories about Africa.
I don't know if I'll ever feel that again like I felt it.
What do you mean by that?
I mean, it was just the biggest opening of my heart I've ever felt. Like, it did something. It's changed me. Everything about me changed in that moment. The value of just that connection that they have. Just how important every single person's gift is. How important every moment is with each person you have. And they know that, and they live it daily. It's just the best.
It's astounding to watch you on the verge of tears and an ecstatic joy simultaneously. It is absolutely amazing being here with you. We're about to take another break. And remember, if you want those tickets, call in at 949-715-5936. And that's tickets to Tres Voces. And that will be next weekend, the 28th. We'll be right back after this song.
Na 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 oh, baba we. Na 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 we. Undi gero la wai baba. Ero nagi 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 roku no mana lepto chende. Undi gero na la wai baba nagi urku. Ero nagi 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 roku no mana lepto chende. Na 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 wo ba we, na 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 we, na 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 wo ba ba we, na 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 we. Tukunde monyono golie machiro, tukunde monyono golie mana machiro. Kamungiyo iro to woke. Undigero la wai baba, ero nagi 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 rwaku no mana lebjo chinde. Undigero la wai baba, nagi 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 rwaku no mana lebjo chinde. Na 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 oh baba we, na 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 we, na 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 oh baba we na 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 we
into Inner Journey, where we help you realize, make real the life of your choosing. We are incredibly fortunate tonight to have Susan Hough with us. But first, we actually have somebody that called in. Hello, who am I speaking with?
This is Anna Krajak.
Hello, Anna. Welcome to Inner Journey.
I would like to ask her, what is her favorite part in the work that she does?
My favorite part in the work that I do is the ritual part, but I think it's about helping parents to understand their teenager better by looking at their chart and getting this like whole information about what would help them to really hear and know their child's gift more fully.
Thank you
very much for calling in. We're going to put you back on hold, and we really do appreciate you listening to Inner Journey. Somebody's coming into town, aren't they?
Sibomfu Somei is coming in town November 15th and 16th at the Neighborhood Congregational Church.
And what's she going to be doing there?
She's going to be doing an intimacy ritual, into me see. So it is wonderful for couples, but it's also wonderful for you if you're single too. It's about really finding the different levels of what intimacy really is in an African ritual way, which is really different than probably what most people have done.
And that's going to be when?
November 15th and 16th.
And how do people get a hold of it if they'd like to participate?
They can call me at 703-505-5152 or go
way too fast.
703-505-5152.
Perfect.
And they can also go to my webpage, which is livingyourgifts.com, and you'll see it there also.
Livingyourgifts.com.
Mm-hmm.
Terrific. And you also have an event coming up this week, right?
I do. I have the beginning of my women's circle. I'm so excited, where we'll do rituals and support each other as women with Jen Hutchison, who is my partner in this. And it's really about honoring women coming together and making a shift in the world and really knowing that we are so much better when we come together than when we're alone.
That goes for women, that goes for men.
Everybody.
That goes for coyotes, that goes for everything all down the line.
I don't like to do anything alone, which I told you earlier today. I believe that I am better when I'm doing things with other people.
That's absolutely beautiful. So one more time, if they'd like to participate in this event this week,
go to livingyourgifts.com and look it up, and you can sign up online. It's going to be great.
You have been an absolute pleasure. I am truly blessed for the opportunity to have met you and absolutely blessed for having gotten to spend time with you. Thank you.
And I feel the same. Thank you so much.
You are quite welcome.
Mm-hmm.
You've been listening to Inner Journey with Greg Friedman. as you saw tonight, I can't always get to the questions. If I haven't been able to get to you, please feel free to email me at greg@gregfriedman.com. Also, if you want to share some news, notes, inspirations, if you want to get some, please check out my Facebook page, which is also innerjourneywithgregfriedman.com. I am incredibly fortunate to have Danny Donair as my production assistant. He's an author in his own right, and please check out his book, 7 Years and 7 Days, A Life of Now. It's excellent, and you can check him out at gardenrule.com. That's gardenrule.com. As I always say, because it's absolutely true, I cannot begin to thank all of you enough. This show doesn't exist without your participation. For that and so much more, I am grateful. Thank you for listening to Inner Journey, and have a lovely evening.